Good afternoon to all of you, and thank you to the organization for giving me the opportunity to give this keynote speech at this Concrete Days, which is digital, obviously, for the reasons we all know. What I will tell you is a story, a love story between BESIX and Concrete, which is a love story which is now ongoing for more than a century. And I will give you a bit of insights of what we did in the past with Concrete, but also look forward towards this incredible material. So the content of my speech is about what we have done in the past with Concrete and some of our major achievements, but also looking at the future of Concrete, because I think it has a bright future, but it needs to reinvent itself. So a short introduction about our company, BESIX. So we are the biggest contractor in Belgium, but we have a lot of our activities overseas. And we are active today in about 25 countries and have over 12,000 people employed in our company. Here you can see some of the realizations we have done recently in Belgium. We are both active in infrastructure works like ports and tunnels, but also in buildings and in environment projects like wastewater treatment. And we do essentially the same in all countries in the world where we are active, whether it's in the Middle East, Australia, or in any other country we are working in. What is important to know is that BESIX, we don't want to be a simple contractor, but we want to be a contractor that adds value, that creates solutions that others cannot think of. And these are some of the domains of expertise in which we are active and which are relevant for the topic we are discussing today, which is Concrete. It's like sustainability. We are very active. We have a very big in-house engineering department, which supports our sites with design and our clients with design process support, soil mechanics and concrete technology. And we have a large group of draftsmen and technicians. As I said, we want to focus on solutions in which we add value for our clients and for the projects, but also for ourselves, of course. And that is what we call value engineering. And it's trying to find solutions that improve the quality, improve the budget, and improve the planning. And that's, the, I would say, the fil rouge, or the rode draad, as they say in Dutch, in the work we try to do as BESIX worldwide. And I will give you now some examples of how we have worked with Concrete over the last century. So we have always used Concrete since our origin in 1908 and the rebuilding of the European river and port infrastructures after the First World War. We have worked with Concrete all along our 112-year history in extreme conditions and for demanding projects. And that requires a lot of knowledge and creativity when using Concrete. And I will give us a few tangible examples. This is an example of one of the stadiums that will be used for the 2022 Qatar World Championship in Doha, near Doha. It's Al Wakra. And we have used, for example, cement with low heat of hydration, minimization of cement contents, and in integration of cooling pipes in the concrete in order to make sure that the concrete is durable and of high quality. We have done it under extreme hot temperature, but also under extreme low temperature. This is an example of a bridge we have built, we have inaugurated last year in Denmark. It's the Crown Prince Mary Bridge. And there we have used heating wires, and we have integrated them in the concrete in order to make sure that concrete is of the right quality. So high temperatures. We are very proud of this record. It's maybe probably known to some of you, but we have the world's world record on pumping concrete at heights, which is currently at 585 meters high. And we use that technique, which we developed in-house. We use that technique on when we built the Burj Khalifa in between 2008 and 2010. This is a very nice picture, which shows a test setup we made in order to test the principles of pumping concrete at a height of over 500 meters. You can see the tubes, which were more than 1 kilometer long when we did the test setup. Pumping concrete on large surfaces, as also in Dubai, in some cases we needed to do operations carried out in one go over very large areas. Here you can see a concrete pour of more than 6,500 cubic meters. at the speed of 300 cubic meters per hour, which we used for the raft of the Dubai Creek Tower. And here you can see the spectacular end result we achieved. The quality of the concrete was just incredible, although we had to pump such amounts at such velocity. We also do a lot of, we are also quite proud of our expertise in marine projects. And this is the concreting, which is carried out in Bahrain, so also in the Gulf area, where we needed to work at 4 kilometers offshore. And so we made a floating batching plant, which was also developed by our in-house concrete technology. So that's also something we are very proud of. And then there's, of course, our activities in countries like Ivory Coast. And here you see a wastewater treatment plant in Ivory Coast, where there's no BENORA. So no, we don't know the standards like we know them in Belgium. And so this requires a lot of testing, providing proof of the quality of the concrete to our client. And we can use all the knowledge which has been developed in Belgium in order to export this to countries like Ivory Coast. But let me talk about the future of concrete, because I think we are in a very crucial time for this incredible material. So concrete was the miracle of construction industry. I think without the invention of concrete and afterwards reinforced concrete, the industry as we know it would be completely different. But it has become its main problem, is my statement. We can and must reinvent it, make it a new miracle again to contribute to a more sustainable world. And BESIX participates in these initiatives in a number of fields, which I will now share with you. So first of all, there's green concrete. There are many ways to make concrete more sustainable. So we have alternative binders like alkali activated materials, geopolymers as an example, cement with lower carbon footprint, capture the CO2 which is in the concrete, replace natural aggregates by recycled aggregates, reduce waste with, for example, 3D concrete printing, and improve transportations, logistics, low emission, and electrical mixer trucks. Those are all elements which can contribute to a much lower environmental footprint impact of concrete, and which can help us to reinvent this material for the next century. An example was when we built the Fort Locke of Lannay. BESIX used locally available natural material. So the project required about 220,000 tons of concrete and 22,000 cubic meters of road concrete. The volume of the aggregates processed of concrete was over 300,000 cubic meters. And we used local materials in order to lower the impact of the concrete produced and used. But this requires also, and this is something where I think we all as experts and all the people in this meeting can help, we need to adapt regulations and norms. The use of concrete with reduced carbon footprint requires adaptations to existing norms, which can reassure investors and property developers, because we see it way too often that when we propose to use more sustainable concrete, it is simply discarded because it is not fully compliant with the codes we use currently in Europe. So we all need to put pressure on all those bodies which can help us in adapting regulations so these more sustainable materials can become more common. This is also something in which we participate. So it's an example of self-healing concrete. But what I want to address here is that by working together with academics and startups and smaller companies, we can also help to create more sustainable kinds of concrete. And for example, this is a project which is called Smartings. It's an EU-sponsored project to produce self-healing concrete, and BESIX acts as an industrial mentor and a member of the board of this research initiative. Another very interesting combination is concrete and digitization. So IoT or Internet of Things offers solutions to monitor concrete maturity in real time with the aim not to be more conservative than needed, because we all know that codes are quite conservative because when we don't know, we add safety factors on the way we design structures and material. Well, if we monitor better, we have better data. And when we have better data, we can be less conservative and therefore use less material and produce less carbon. This is something which we used also in the project I mentioned earlier. It's the wastewater treatment plant in Ivory Coast, where we used a company called Sensorhive to do quite extensive monitoring of the produced concrete. 3D printing. We have a 3D printing lab in Dubai, and 3D concrete printing execution time, noise, and waste, and allows for greater creativity in shapes. And this picture shows an example in which all those facade panels, which you can see on this slide, were 3D printed in our own 3D printing lab in Dubai and used for the extension of our head office in Dubai. It's not structural yet, but it's a great example of how these new technologies can influence our industry. And then finally, I think, and that's my final comments during this keynote speech, is that the future of concrete make it a miracle again. So disruptive change is needed. I think we all know that we need to flatten the curve of climate change. This requires collective and decisive action. And I think if I can make the parallel with the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic, I think we have seen what we can achieve when we collectively want to achieve something. And I think we need to do the same when it comes to climate change, and within climate change, when it comes to construction industry. And so we, the construction industry, and I'm a very optimistic person, we have an unprecedented opportunity. And I want to share a last example of what this future could bring. So I think our main challenges are pollution, waste, and material depletion. Pollution, I mean carbon footprint impact. What is the unprecedented opportunity we have is that computational fabrication makes ancient methods affordable. And those ancient methods have always used much material than we use today. And we enter, for that reason, we enter into a decade of co-creation with a real paradigm shift, which we need to achieve jointly, in which we do not manage our liabilities in construction projects, but in which we take leadership on sustainable responsibilities. And you can see here a picture of a shell which was built in Africa, with material carried by these women on their head. And this material only has a strength of 2 megapascal. And you can see that people are walking on top of this structure. And this has inspired some fascinating research group around the world. And there's one I would love to highlight. It's part of the ETH University in Zurich. It's called the Block Research Group. The leading professor is Philippe Block, which is a Belgian. And he's leading a big research group on digital fabrication. And they've inspired with ancient construction techniques. And you can see here the roof on the top left of the Oyster Bar in New York. And they've used that building technique to create a new type of slabs, which they are standing on with their complete research team on the bottom left, which uses funicular floors and much less material than traditional concrete slabs. And I think that's the future of construction. And it's our collective responsibility to co-create with universities to achieve this impact, because doing nothing is not an option anymore. So that was my keynote speech for this afternoon. I hope you enjoyed it. And I look forward in working with a lot of you in the near future to create a more sustainable future for concrete. Thank you very much.